Well, with that song, I'll give you a belated welcome to Edenville Baptist Church. We're glad for those that made it out today. We'd like to thank you for coming out. We did have 163 in Sunday school. Got some things to announce for today. Baptism in the AM service after Brother Brian finishes today. Senior reception team meeting at 5 p.m. in Brother David Stevens' office. And choir practice at 4:30. Saturday, TLC event from 4 to 7 p.m. And then if you'll notice on the inside of your bulletin, Brother Brian wanted me to stress the Passover Seder, a dinner of theology and a drama of Messiah with your Eatonville Baptist Church family, and that will be Sunday, March 24th, 2013. So, and if you can help with that, with bringing the food for the Seder, please see June Dishman or Sue Harmon so they can arrange and know how many people for whom to cook. So we look forward to that. Also, I've been asked about nursery and children's church. Some of the folks here that are new may not know that we have a nursery, so I'm going to read the note that was given to me. It says, we welcome children in the service with us. And we have nursery facilities for babies through 3 years old in the Family Life Center behind this building. We also have children's church for four-year-olds through fourth graders that will dismiss later in the service. So if you want to know about nursery or children's church, we do have nursery for babies to 3 years old and children's church from 4 years old through fourth grade. I think Trey still tries to slip in there, and he's in fifth grade, but it's supposed to go through fourth grade. So if our ushers would come forward, we would like to recognize any guests or visitors who may be here. If you are a guest or a visitor, we're going to give you a pen like this from the church with a card attached, and we would ask that you would return the card and the offering plate as your offering to us today and keep the pen as a gift from the church today. And also, on your way out, on my left in our vestibule, we have a bit larger gift for you, so please stop by and pick that up as a token of our appreciation for you coming today. If you are a guest or a visitor, if you would remain seated just until you get your card so that our ushers can identify who you are, that would help us out greatly. And if our members and regulars will stand, we'll now fellowship. Thanks.
I'd like for you to join us this morning as we worship together in song.
The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, worship His holy name. I sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will
us pray.
Just when you think things couldn't get any more exciting around here, huh?
Boy, you've got that right. What with the flies and the boils and the locusts, I thought I'd seen everything. But boy, this last one, the plague of darkness, that was really creepy.
Speaking of plagues, what about this next one coming up? Are you going to do the whole lamb thing?
Oh, yeah, I'm going to do the whole lamb thing. Heck, if a little splattered lamb's blood on my front door keeps me from losing my son, you better believe I'm going to do the whole lamb's thing. You know, I'm beginning to think we can finally get free this time. Wouldn't that be something? Out from under the Egyptians, able to grow and built for us our own, not for the Pharaoh.
Amen to that, brother. Father, have you picked your lamb out yet?
Indeed, I have.
Darkness came the light. Out of nothingness before the world you were. Bless your name forevermore, Lord, according to your plan. You created every man just to glorify you, and bless your name forevermore. Then into the world you came by the power of your name, and you washed my sins away. Bless your name forevermore. So I come before your throne through no goodness of my own, and I worship you alone. Bless your name forevermore. I will bless your name
distance, God saw a cross. When Cain killed his brother, God was watching, and God saw a cross.
Moses slew the Egyptian man in anger. God saw
tell you, you don't want to miss any Sundays here building up to Easter. It's going to get better and better and better as we just focus upon what Jesus Christ did for us upon Calvary and in that final day of celebration, the resurrection. And so, like I said, don't miss a day. Invite someone to come out with you on Sunday mornings. This is going to be awesome. And then don't forget Sunday nights. Jason's going to be sharing with us a study he did many years ago on the temple. And I was telling Jason this morning, the thing I remember about that, God delivered the people of Israel out of Egypt so they could worship him in the desert. Folks, it's all about worship, and it's so exciting as Jason's going to be leading us that. So make sure you come back tonight. Jason's going to kick that off tonight. And then do go ahead and sign up for the Passover Seder. It's just awesome again as it just points to Jesus Christ, all the different things. And Reginald does just a wonderful job as he will lead us in that. But June needs a good count about how much food that we need to fix and all. So make sure you sign up for that. Put that in the bulletin or, in the offering plate, or let June or Connie or somebody know if you and your family's going to come for that, okay? And just invite guests. We just want as many as we can get because it's going to just point to Jesus Christ. Well, the focus of our message today is the necessity of the Lamb. You know, the Old Testament text in Sunday school was the choosing of the Passover lamb that would be slain, as we've just already sang about and talked about, where the blood would be sprinkled up on the doorpost so the death angel would pass over and not kill the firstborn. And so, of course, the sacrificial lamb, as the drama pointed to, it was just a picture of Jesus Christ. Because God loved us so much, he sent his Son into this world that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. And so as we prepare for Easter, like I said, that day of resurrection, the day of celebration when our Lord rose from the grave that gave us that hope and of heaven one day, and I want to just introduce to you today the Lamb of God. And so won't we stand? Let's just begin in prayer. We'll be looking at the three different passages. If you want to, you can turn to Luke chapter 2. That's where we're going to begin this morning. But as we, again, look to the Lamb, we want to introduce the Lamb this morning. Lord, our Heavenly Father, we just love you so very much. Lord, thank you so much for the sense of your Holy Spirit here this morning. Lord, I thank you so much that we could come just to worship and to praise your holy and precious name. Lord, may we just never forget what it meant that Lord, that you came into this world. You're holy and perfect, and yet you loved us so much that you went to that cross and you took our ugly and awful sin upon yourself so that we could be forgiven. And Lord, may we just, out of a heart of gratitude and love and thanksgiving, Lord, may we just worship you and praise you, and Lord, may we serve you with our lives. And Lord, I just to pray right now as we go into this message today, is that we kind of introduce the Lamb, that Lord, that those that don't know you, that Lord, that they would give their life to you. Perhaps there's those here that are Christians, that Lord, that's been running from you, that Lord, again, let them see that Lord, you've got good plans for our life. You don't want to harm us, but you want to bless us and prosper us, and it all begins by being obedient. And then Lord, that those that don't know you, may they come and receive the Lamb this morning. And so, Lord, we just thank you so much for what you're going to do, and we give you the glory and praise for it all. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Like I said, let's just start where the drama ended with the birth of the Lamb. Like I said, turn to Luke chapter 2 if you're not there yet. And the story of Christ's birth, that's a familiar one to us, and we preach about that each Christmas. But notice here in Luke chapter 2, let's begin there in verse 7. Then she brought forth Mary, the firstborn son, Jesus, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone around about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace and goodwill towards men. Peace on earth. Yet, you know, Christ's life and his death was anything but peaceful. It began in controversy. It would end at Calvary. You know, that first Christmas itself was not a Disney Christmas, you know, filled with magic and fireworks and everything nice. But yet the exciting news is that we can find peace in Christ's birth. You know, that calm assurance that our God loves us, that calm assurance that he's in control of our life, and he's working all things, good and bad, out for our good and for his glory. And so the angel says to the shepherds here who were afraid, we notice there in verse 9, he says, fear not. You know, I bring you good news. I bring you great joy, for a Savior is born that would save sinners from their sin, that can save us from death and hell. You know, Jesus was born to be our Passover lamb. Listen, he's the answer to our problem of death. He's the answer to the problem of hell. He's the way to eternal life. He's the way to heaven this morning. Listen, we can celebrate that good news. Jesus is the answer. You know, in our study of the Gospel of John, we've been seeing over and over again that Jesus is the answer. We said that Jesus saves us and he satisfies us forever. And it doesn't really matter what the question is. If we said before, if it's a question worth asking, Jesus Christ is the answer. You know, who am I? I'm a human being that's been created in the very image of Almighty God and created for fellowship with God. And we can only have that fellowship through his Son, Jesus Christ. Or I like the question, why am I here? Folks, Jesus is the answer. I'm here to worship him. I'm here to walk with my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I'm here to work for my Lord. Again, thanksgiving and gratitude to him. I'm here to proclaim the good news of Jesus to the world. And I can tell you this morning, our hearts are restless and longing until we find our rest within him. And then where am I going? Of course, Jesus is the answer to that. Life is passing by so quickly, and before we turn it around, we're going to be faced with eternity. We're not promised tomorrow. And you know, the Bible says there are only two destinations for eternity, heaven or hell. John 1:12 says, as many as receive Christ, he's given authority to become the very children of God. And he promised in John 14 at the end of life that he has gone away and prepared a place for us. And if he's gone away and prepared a place for us, he's coming again to take us to himself. Isn't that good news? But you know, if you're here and you reject Jesus Christ's sacrifice for your sin, you will not go to heaven, but to a place of eternal damnation, a place of hell, separated from God. And God doesn't want anyone to go there. John 1:18 says, he who does not believe is condemned already for not believing on the only begotten Son of God. So without a doubt, listen, Jesus Christ is the answer. And if you haven't already, you can find him this morning. Jesus has promised he's here with us. He's here with his church, and he's reaching out to you today. You know, the shepherds here, they found the answer in Christ. You know, Jesus came into the world for he's the only way to get to God. You know, if you could get to God by just being a good person or by giving this or that, you know, Jesus would have died in vain. He would have died for nothing. And I'm here to tell you, Jesus did not die for nothing. He died for you. He died for me. God wants us to be reconciled to himself, and it can only happen as we give our lives over to him. Like I said in verse 9 there, notice again, when the angels appeared to the shepherd, it said they were terribly afraid. And listen, when we realize who we are, sinners undone before a holy and righteous God, that's exactly the response that we will have. He brings us to our knees. And the whole idea that God is like some big brother or he's some chummy friend that we can have, he's just the big guy upstairs. Listen, that is totally crazy. That is totally insane. Our God, the Bible says, is a consuming fire. It's a fearful thing to fall in the hands of the living God. And if you think that you can approach God in just a casual way, that it doesn't matter how I live, it doesn't matter if you know I do or don't do what he says in his word, that God is just going to accept me, everything's going to be fine. Listen, you are wrong. In Scripture, those who come into the Lord's presence, they are undone. And they fall upon their knees. The shepherd was sore afraid. They bowed to the ground. God cannot help a person until you rightly view who he is. He is the creator. He's the holy. He's the righteous God. And rightly view who we are. We are sinful. We deserve nothing but death and judgment. You know, coming to God is understanding how great that he is and how small and sinful and unworthy we are in his presence. You know, until you get those two pictures, you cannot be reconciled to God. And so this is the question for you this morning. What is the circumstances God is using in your life right now to humble you, to bring you to Him? What is the uncertainty that has you afraid to face tomorrow? What is the painful situation? What's the difficulty God is using to bring you to a place of humility before Him? Where you can say honestly from your heart, yes, God, I need you. Yes, God, I am sinful. I'm undone before you. God, would you please help me? God, would you please save me? That's where we've got to come. And isn't it wonderful when we come to Him? He doesn't kick us when we're down. When we finally humble ourselves before Him, he comes and He saves us through His grace. He brings us to the point of humility so that we can look up to Him, so He can embrace us, He can ensure us. He told the shepherds, do not be afraid. You know, every time in Scripture when a person is brought to their knees before God, the first words from our Lord's mouth is, do not be afraid. God makes us afraid and then tells us, don't be afraid. He brings us to the place that we acknowledge His holiness. We acknowledge His greatness, His powerfulness, His bigness, His majesty. Then He pours out His mercy. Then He pours out His love and His grace upon us by embracing us. That's the good news, church, of the gospel of Jesus Christ. In Revelation 1. John said he was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and he fell at Jesus' feet as if he was dead, but yet Jesus placed His hand upon him and said, do not be afraid. Listen, God doesn't want His children cowering in fear. He wants us on our knees so that we can realize who we are, who He is, and He gives us the good news there in verse 10. Behold, I bring you good tidings, great joy, which shall be to all people. You know, I was thinking our world needs some good news. Amen. Good news of great joy. This is what our world desperately needs. And He says it's for all people. It's for you today if you've not received Him. That's the good news. You're here that in the city of David, a Savior, which is Christ the Lord, would be born. That Jesus Christ came into this world to solve our problem. The main problem is the problem of sin that we could not solve ourselves. That sin that has separated from God. That sin that condemned us. And the Bible says we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. That we've all, like sheep, have gone astray. Yet Jesus, you know, lived that sinless life. He died as our substitute for our sin so that we could be forgiven. And the good news is you don't have to go to hell. The good news is you don't have to be separated from God for all of eternity. The good news is you can come to Jesus this morning. You know, when I open the paper every day, it's just bad news and bad news and bad news. But the good news, God loves you. His Son Jesus died for you. He rose from the grave to prove that He is God. We can become God's children. We can be saved through repentance, turning from my sin. Through faith, believing Jesus' payment was enough. Oh, the good news is God has come in the flesh. He's come as a man. He's our Passover lamb. Isn't that wonderful? And He's here with us this morning. And He wants to fill our hearts with peace. Verse 14, it says, then glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men. Peace is the word shalom. It just means that well-being, peace and joy at every level in this life and the life to come. You know, I've got it, you know, going on with the Lord. I'm at peace with Him. I got it going on with others. I'm at peace with them. Peace comes to those who God's favors rest upon. So how do we get God's favor? Saying, Brian, you know, you've been talking about how do we get this peace and this joy within our lives. Again, you come on God's terms. You cannot have God's favor on your own terms. You cannot have your own way. It's not your own plan. Well, Brian, I don't like the plan that talks about death. Don't like the plan that talks about crucifixion. I don't like the plan that talks about I got to pick up my cross daily and follow Him. Listen, if that's the case, you got a real problem this morning. You got to come on God's terms.
Listen, your terms are not so great. They will lead you away from God. They bring pain into our lives. They will bring death. Ultimately, they bring hell. And if you was honest this morning, as you look back over your life, every time you got away from God, every time you make your own choices, selfish choices apart from God's word, it's brought nothing but chaos within your life. It's brought nothing but heartache and pain for others within your life. But when you understand who God is, He's holy and He's loving. He's our creator. He's the sustainer. He's the sovereign of the universe. Who else's terms could we possibly think we could come to Him on? I'm pretty sure this morning, church, He knows a whole lot more than what we know. It's His terms. And if you want God's favor in your life and eternity, come to God on His terms. There is no other terms. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father except by me. Hebrews says there's one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. Love Acts 4:12, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And so it's His way. It's that narrow road the Bible talks about, the only true way, and then our hearts are filled with His peace. The birth of the Lamb. We need the Lamb of God. Now, second, if you want to, just skip over to John chapter 1. And I believe this verse was in your Sunday school lesson this morning. And notice not only the birth of the Lamb, you know, Jesus lived and sinless and a normal life until He began His ministry. And now we come to the announcement of the Lamb. And in this chapter, if you recall when we studied this, John's gospel, already in chapter 1, he tells us Jesus is God, that He's creator of all things, that Jesus is the one that gives life, that Jesus is the light that has come into the world to shine in its darkness, yet many have rejected Him because they love their sin and darkness more than they love God. And then in the latter part here, He sends John the Baptist as a witness to Jesus as that light so people would believe. And then John makes this awesome testimony or this awesome statement there in verse 29 when he sees Jesus coming to him in the wilderness. It said, the next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him and said, behold, the Lamb of God, which takes away the sins of the world. Man, that's awesome. You know, as you read throughout the Old Testament, you just read of one sacrifice after another. There's just a river of blood that runs through the Old Testament. And many people are kind of offended about the shedding of innocent blood. But you know, every sacrifice pointed to that someone who was coming, that perfect, that sinless Lamb that Ephesians tells us that was slain even before the foundation of the world for our sins. And with the coming of Jesus, there's an answer to that cry from Isaac there on Mount Moriah. He says, Father, where is the Lamb? And Abraham replied, God will provide a Lamb. And then centuries later, as John saw Jesus coming towards him, he announces to the crowd, behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. Man, that's exciting. You know, John didn't introduce Jesus, even though he could, as the Son of God. He didn't introduce him as the Holy One of God or the Christ of God or the Word of God. He went straight to the main purpose here. He goes straight to the heart of the matter, our need today. He declares Jesus is the Lamb of God. You know, John's baptism, he confronted the people with their need for repentance. They confronted them with their sin, but they needed more than repentance. They needed redemption. They needed a redeemer. All the water in the world could not wash away the stains of their sin. Only the blood of of Jesus Christ, not a blood of an animal, not an ordinary lamb, but the Lamb of the precious blood of God. So the entire message of the Bible could be summed up this morning in this. The question in the Old Testament, where is the Lamb? And the gospel emphasis on, behold, the Lamb of God, He is here. You know, and even as John spoke those words, the crowd could see the flocks of lambs being taken to Jerusalem to be sacrificed at the Passover feast. So John was saying there's only one true sacrifice who can deliver you from your death. That is Jesus Christ. He's our deliverer. The announcement of the Lamb. Listen, you and I, we need the Lamb. And for some of you here this morning, those first two points in God's word is God's word for you today. Are you lost? You know, if you died tonight, would you die, not go to heaven but go to hell, or if you die tonight, you just really are confused. You don't know where you'd spend eternity at. Listen, God in his great love, God in his great grace is speaking to you right now. He says, come to me. Let me forgive you your sins. Let me save you. Let me give you eternal life. And when I give an invitation here in just a few moments, you need to come to this altar for salvation. And in church, this final point is for us this morning. Once we're saved, just go ahead and flip over to Revelation chapter 5. Once we're living for Jesus, this last point is so exciting for the Lamb. We're living for Jesus Christ. He's coming again. We, his people, can live victoriously as overcomers in this world through our Savior. We're excited to worship and praise the one who died for us so that we could live. Revelation 5 here today. And as I was saying earlier, I think this passage means even more to me after going through Jason's teaching here on the temple and the worship. And, you know, like I said, they were delivered to worship him. We're saved to worship our God. Amen. The Apostle John, in a vision, he stands before the throne of God, and he's crying because the world's just out of control. It's under Satan's control because of sin. And, you know, you're familiar with this. We've taught on this several times, but there's no one, you know, worthy to open, I think it's the title deed of the earth, to fulfill God's plan. So John's crying. He's weeping here, and maybe even uncontrollably, because the world is in Satan's grip. And notice there in verse 5, he says, and one of the elders saith unto him, to me, John, weep not. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah and the root of David hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. And what we're going to see is, John, quit crying. It's time to start shouting. It's time to start singing unto our Lord. Verse 6, I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts and the midst of the elders stood a lamb as it had been slain. And notice that word slain there just means that his throat has been cut. It actually meant that he'd been slaughtered, and having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into the earth. And of course, this lamb is Jesus Christ. And he says seven eyes just means he sees everything perfectly. Listen, there's not anything you're pulling over on Jesus Christ. He sees within your heart this morning. He knows exactly what's going on in your mind today. He doesn't miss anything. And in that seven horns, this means his perfect power. He has perfect power, and we're going to see he's going to come back one day to bring judgment upon this earth and set up his earthly kingdom. And then, of course, he was filled with the Holy Spirit and controlled by him. Verse 7, and he came and took the book out of the right hand of him that sat upon the throne. Listen, Jesus is worthy to take the scroll, for he's paid the price. He's the one that was slain for our sins. He's purchased people. We're going to see from every tribe and every nation and every language. The scroll is just the destiny of mankind. That mystery, that secret of God's will. And a mighty angel asked, who's worthy to open the seals? Who's to bring about God's righteous judgment upon the earth? He says, no one, no man in the earth, no one under the earth, no power can do this. But he says, don't cry, because the lamb that was slain, he is the king. He is the judge. He's our redeemer. He's our risen, majestic, powerful Son of God. And he is worthy. Folks, that's why we come out and to worship our God each week. Look at verse 8 now. And here he gets into this, the worship. He says, and when he had taken the book of the four beasts and the 24 elders, fell down before the Lamb, having every one of them harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sung a new song, saying, thou art worthy to take the book, to open the seals thereof, for thou wast slain, and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation. Hast made us unto all to our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. Verse 11, and I beheld and heard the voice of many angels round about the throne, and the beast and the elders, and the number of them are 10,000 times 10,000, thousands of thousands. And so Jesus is standing in the middle of the throne, and he's worshipped by the four living creatures, the elders, the angels, all created things worship Jesus Christ. Amen. He is worthy. And you can worship him now as you come to him willingly. Or one day, we're told in Philippians, wherefore God has highly exalted Jesus, giving him a name above every name, that the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, of things in heaven, things in the earth, things under the earth, and that every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. You know, in chapter 6, he begins to open these judgments, and the wickedness will be dealt with, and all the horrible things that we see in our world today. You know, when you read about murders or molestation or rape or crime, all that stuff will be dealt with. It will all be made right. The righteous, the worthy judge will make it right. The judgment will come from the one who died in our place. Listen, he loves you. He knows all things. He's the righteous judge. He's the center of all worship in heaven. Folks, we want to get a step up on that. We want to worship him now in spirit and truth. Amen. Man, one day we'll be on that worship team in heaven. And then after that judgment comes up on the earth, we're told that, you know, there'll be a new heaven and earth. And praise the Lord, we will reign for eternity with our God. Man, we have a glorious future to look forward to. Now, I was thinking of the roll call of the saints there in Hebrews 11. You know, many of them paid the price that we would never have to pay in this world, perhaps. But they paid the price of torture and death for following God. The Bible said that the world was not even worthy of them. They call them overcomers. They didn't shrink back, even though many of them was, he says, sawn in two, some terrible ways that they died. Many of them was martyred. And that's what God wants from us. Now get this. God wants each of us to love him with all of our hearts, all of our souls, all of our mind, and our strength. Folks, that's where the joy in the Christian life comes from, when we give everything over to our God who is worthy. Oh, we want the world to know he's more important to us than anything. More important than sports, more important than material stuff, more important than entertainment. He's more important than everything, even our families. Listen, Jesus Christ is everything to us. He wants the same position in our hearts as he has in the universe. He's on his throne. Is he on the throne of your heart? He's worthy. He paid for it. He deserves it all. Verse 12, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. Now, that just describes who Jesus Christ is. Jesus is worthy to receive power. He's all powerful. He's able to do all things. He's worthy to receive wealth. I mean, Jesus provides for our every need. In Haggai, it says that God says he, the silver is his and the gold is mine. Paul refers in Ephesians to the unsearchable riches of Christ. And third, it says the Lamb is worthy because he has all wisdom. Now get this, even though sometimes we don't understand the things going on in our life, God does the right thing at the right time and always in the best way. Amen. That's the God that we serve. He's worthy to receive all might. He's going to return one day in power. He's the King of kings. He's the Lord of lords. We're going to sing to the Lamb because he's worthy of all honor. Now, I was thinking on that point. I don't know about you. It just breaks my heart when I turn the TV on or I watch a movie or just out in public and that type of thing. Just how our world dishonors, how Jesus' name is blasphemed and ridiculed. But one day, every knee will bow. Because our Lord is worthy. And he's worthy of glory. You know, I like that word. That's just referring to his splendor. The fame that characterizes everything about him. Amen. He is perfect and our Lord is beautiful in every way. His love and his grace and his holiness, his mercy, even his justice. It's all beautiful. It's all his glory. And we'll praise him for that glory. And then last, he said, he is worthy of all blessings. And that word blessing is the word we get eulogy from. You know, we say some nice words about someone who dies. But this is wonderful because it's talking about we're going to say great things about the living Christ. He's our Savior. He's our Lord. He's our friend. He's the Lamb
that is coming back. Isn't it wonderful? Jesus said that there's no greater love than this for a man to lay down his life for his friends, and I lay down my life for you. You know, our God is big and he's awesome, he's mighty, he's transcendent, but also he's intimate and he's loving towards us. We who are his children were the object of his affection. And he purchased it with his blood. He cares for us. And as you give your life over to him, listen, your future, your needs, your struggles, your pain, Jesus will be there for you. And then let's finish up here in verse 13 and 14. And every creature which is in heaven and on the earth, under the earth, and such as are in the sea, and all that's in them, heard I saying, blessing and honor and glory and power unto him that sitteth upon the throne, unto the Lamb forever and ever. And the four beasts said, Amen. And the 24 elders fell down and worshipped him that liveth forever and ever. You know, the sad fact is, not everybody will be part of that worshiping God and Jesus Christ in heaven. Some of you may be familiar with Marianne Williamson, who taught a course called Miracles on Oprah Winfrey's network. Let me just give you a phrase that she says about our crucified Lord. She said, a slain Christ has no meaning. The only message of the crucifixion is that you can overcome the cross. Do not make the pathetic error of clinging to the old rugged cross. Listen, that is the world's lies. That is Satan's lie. The truth is, you better not make the pathetic error of ignoring the old rugged cross today. You know, Paul says, and we can echo with that as his church, God forbid that we should glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. If you ignore the crucified Savior, if you reject the cross of Jesus Christ, you will die in your sins without hope forever. But if we accept the crucified Savior and believe in the death of Christ for our sins, if we believe after he was buried, he rose again on that third day, then we'll have a new heaven and there'll be a new earth and we'll live there with our Savior forever and ever. Ignore and die in your sins and suffer the consequences forever. Believe it and live unto Christ in his coming kingdom forever. Listen, we cling to the old rugged cross. Listen, I don't know about you, but as I was worshiping in the Lord today in our service and in this message, I was thinking, what a great way to start the Easter season. Amen. By seeing the need for the Lamb of God. By proclaiming that the Lamb is worthy. And if you belong to the Lamb, be encouraged. You can remain faithful even when our world falls apart. So let's live with the end in mind that Jesus is coming back for his people. We know who's on the throne. God's in control, no matter how bad the world might look. We know who's standing before the throne. Jesus, who will judge the earth in justice. He's coming back, and we will reign with him for all of eternity. So whatever in your life, hang tough. We are overcomers through our Lord Jesus Christ. And that's the last thing I want to ask. Are you living as an overcomer tonight or today? You know, in your trials, in the difficulties that come within our lives, within our families, within our marriages, within the workplace, and in the temptations, are you really looking forward to being in heaven with our Lord and Savior? Are you looking forward to being there with the God, the Father that loved us so much, he sent his Son, the Holy Spirit, who comes and takes up residence, that we become the very temples of God through the Holy Spirit in worshiping and praising him? You know, are you going through a tough time right now and you think, well, Lord, it's really hard right now. I just don't know if it's worth it. Lord, this don't even seem fair. This is going on in my life. And listen, get a glimpse of heaven's throne today. Get a glimpse of his reward that he said, I'll give you crowns when you're faithful, that you'll hear well done, thy good and faithful servant one day. Get a glimpse of this scene and when we worship God, it will be worth it all one day. Take hope, take comfort in these words. We need the Lamb. Behold the Lamb of God, which take away the sins of the world. Do you need your sins taken away this morning. You can come to Jesus now. Let's stand.